I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Tony Hillerman's haunting tour of terror. The Blessing Way. Starring Ed Nelson. Barbara Anderson. And Tige Andrews. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by
the Ford Motor Company and Metropolitan Life Insurance Company. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
Superstition. Any belief or attitude that is inconsistent with the known laws of science or with what is generally considered in a particular society as true and rational, or so says Webster's Unabridged Dictionary. But who is to say what is true and rational? You decide for yourself. This week, a story of science versus superstition. Dr. Bergen McKee, a scientist of the non-laboratory variety, a cultural anthropologist, a PhD, a published scholar on the subject of Navajo Indian witchcraft, but someone who doubts himself as a man. Dr. Bergen McKee is about to set out into the field to complete some unfinished research. Death is something that is embodied in all societies. Murder is quite something else. And for Dr. Bergen McKee, all the textbooks in the world won't be able to wake him from the terrible nightmare that is waiting for him. Our story, The Blessing Way, will begin after this word. Picture this. A moonlit night above the vast plateau region of northeastern Arizona, Navajo country. Rugged terrain, sandstone laced with granite, cut into hundreds of deep canyons and mazes of arroyos, a crazy quilt of erosion. The valley, bordered on the east by the Lukachukan Mountains, rising still and stoic from the depths of what the Navajo call Many Ruins Canyon. Along the western slope, a faint flickering light, practically invisible. It is a small fire, built in the extreme corner of a natural enclosure, giving the face of Lewis Horseman a reddish cast. It is a young face, thin and sensitive, with large black eyes and a sullen mouth. Lewis Horseman hears nothing but the fire and the wind. It is only when he raises his eyes that he sees the towering shadow of the two-legged wolf who is watching him from behind. Suddenly, he turns and gapes in stark terror at the big man with wolf skin draped across his shoulders, the forepaws hanging down the front of his huge chest, the beast's empty skull pushed back on his forehead, its snout pointing upward.
I won't kill.
400 miles to the east, in Albuquerque, New Mexico, Dr. Bergen McKee, age 38, university professor, Department of Anthropology, sits in his apartment at his desk, grading final examination papers.
Well, that's a very good point, Miss Ferguson. I agree wholeheartedly, but you really should quote your source. Dr. Bergen McKee, Social and Psychotherapeutic Utility of Navajo Wolf and Frenzy Superstitions. Albuquerque, University Press, 1967, pages 71 through 73. You'll never get the graduate degree plagiarizing this way. It happens this way every term. Papers come in. I wait until the very last moment before grades are due. Then I sit up late and curse my students' ineptitude. Slash away with my red pencil and then Wish them all a happy summer vacation on the bottom of the last page. Always the same, predictable Dr. McKee. Ogre in tweeds, the monster slayer and proponent of the scapegoat theory, re-Navajo primitive superstition. I fell asleep at my desk and woke up the morning of May 26th in the same position, hardly fitting for a man like myself. Two letters were on my mind. One of them I'd mailed a month ago to Joe Leaphorn, Navajo Tribal Council, Law and Order Division, Window Rock, Arizona, intimating that I might return to his neck of the woods to resume my studies in the field. I had sent such a letter once a year for the past 6 years, but never went. It was 6 years ago that I'd received the other letter that was on my mind. A note, actually. 15 words in blue ink on blue paper. Berg, I am meeting Scotty in Las Vegas tonight. I won't contest the divorce. Sarah. It was late morning by the time I arrived at the university. I took my mail from the faculty box and had just retreated to my office when...
Berg, where would you look on the Navajo reservation for an electrical engineer testing his gadgets?
Who wants to find him?
A daughter of a friend of mine, a girl named Ellen Leone. She says this guy drives a light green van and is doing some kind of research that has to be away from electrical transmission lines, telephone wires, stuff like that.
Well, that narrows it down to about 90% of the reservation.
Well, I told her we'd look for him.
Did you now?
Well, now, you don't want to make a liar out of your honorable colleague, do you? We'll look. If we don't find him, we don't find him. Doesn't really matter. She'll be coming out herself in a few days.
Are you kidding? A woman?
Beyond question.
About 5'5", slim, long dark hair, and wearing a checkered pantsuit.
You saw her in the hall?
I saw her in the hall. Very pretty.
Mm-hmm. Well, well, what's this?
Hey, Dr. Canfield, do you mind? We may share an office, but that doesn't give you the right to tamper with my mail.
I see you've heard from your boy in Window Rock.
Yeah, Joe Leaphorn.
Leaphorn. Is that an Indian name?
He's a Navajo, if that's what you're asking.
Well, where do you want to start hunting for witches?
Jeremy.
Bergen.
Look, how about starting over in the West Slope, beyond the Lukachukas, the Many Ruins Canyon?
That's my specialty, ruins. If you've got some witches in there to scrutinize, there'd be plenty of ruins to keep me busy.
Jeremy, well, what's the fellow's name with the green truck?
Hall. Jimmy W. Hall, Ph.D. The young woman's name is Ellen Leone. Oh, they're not married, if that's what you're asking. I'm glad you decided to go, Bergen. I think maybe I should ask for a guarantee that your witches won't get me.
My Navajo wools, being strictly psychotherapeutic, are certified harmless. Here, get.
What's this? Looks like a frog.
Reed Clan Totem, one of the holy people. Good for fending off corpse powder. No self-respecting Navajo wolf will bother you now, I guarantee it. Dr. Green got my graded papers by the noon deadline, and I was on my way to Navajo country inside of 48 hours. We packed most of the gear in the Canfield's camper. I drove the pickup on ahead and arranged to stay with Joe Leaphorn and his wife, Emma, for a day or two, however long it would take Jeremy to reach the reservation. In the morning, Joe and I drove to his office at Window Rock, where we got down to business at hand.
I'm afraid that's about all we've got that might interest you, Bergen. We don't know what's going on yet with that business in the Lukachuka area. We got some fourth-hand story about a cave of Navajo wolves somewhere back in the West Slope Canyon. The witches are supposed to be coming around the summer hogans up there, abusing the animals and the usual. And as usual, the stories vary depending on which rumor you hear.
Well, what's your interest in all this, Joe?
It might have something to do with a man we're looking for up there. Or maybe it's a genuine witch who really does turn himself into a werewolf. Wouldn't that knock hell out of you scientific types?
But who are you looking for up there, Joe?
Well, read it for yourself.
Louis Horseman, age 22, son of Annie Horseman of the Red Forehead Clan. Married to Elsie Tso of the Many Goats Clan. Residence, Sabita Wash, 27 miles south of Clegg Toe. Arrest record. Drunk and disorderly, assault and battery, driving under the influence. Well, what's this about a knife?
Horseman cut up a Mexican in Gallup last month, stole a car, and headed for the hills.
Well, how can you find him up there? He could stay hidden forever.
I'm going out to Shoemaker's and spread the word that the Mexican didn't die, that he's alive. The news will get to Horseman, believe me. You coming?
Now? Oh, yeah, sure. It was about a two-hour drive to Shoemaker's, a trading post that had just about everything, food, supplies, clothing. It was also the only post office in that area of the reservation. I spent most of the afternoon sitting in a canvas chair near the door, talking to the few people who came in about any recent witchcraft stories they might have heard. The only name that came up more than once was that of Old Woman Gray Rocks. It seemed she was the source of one of the better rumors. I jotted down her name in my notebook for future reference. Joe Leaphorn was quite thorough in doing what he'd set out to do, spreading the word. He'd repeated the same information over and over, and now he was telling it to the big, bareheaded Navajo who was collecting canned goods off the shelves.
He's sort of skinny, about 22 years old, and he wears his hair the old way. Name of Lewis Horseman.
I don't know him.
The big Navajo gave Joe a long look and then moved to the clothing racks and tried on a black felt hat with a wide brim.
My head got big since the last time I bought a hat. You got the last one stolen.
The man was big, bigger than most Navajos from this part of the reservation. I was sure Joe noticed this too, and he followed him over to the checkout counter. The big Navajo paid for his groceries and a new, larger hat, then drew from his hip pocket a silver concho band that glistened in the store's filtered light.
This Horseman fellow cut up a Mexican over in Gallup. Got drunk and did it, but the Nat guy didn't die. He's getting better now. They want to talk to Horseman about it over at Window Rock.
I don't know anything about him.
He's the son of Annie Horseman. Used to live over in the west slope of the Lukachukas.
Whereabouts on the west slope? Law and order know where he is?
General idea, but it would be better if he came in himself. You know, otherwise we'll have to go and get him. Make it worse for everybody.
Horseman, huh? Is he, come, let's see. What'd you say this kid looks like?
Slender, hat on denims, and a red sweatband.
Be better if he came in.
We got back to Window Rock and the house in time for a late supper. I thanked Joe and his wife for their hospitality and told them tomorrow I'd be meeting my colleague, Dr. Canfield, and the two of us were going to set up camp over in Many Ruins Canyon. Emma was tired, so she wished me luck and went off to bed.
Good night, Emma. I'll be right in. You look beat, Bergen.
It's been a long day, and I don't have much to show for it.
Well, be patient, my friend. You will see our efforts were not a waste of time.
Well, I didn't say it was a waste of time, Joe.
By morning, Lewis Horseman will know he is not a murderer.
Wow. Nobody you talked to knew him.
More than one knew him, or knew of him. Like that joker who bought himself the new hat.
Well, he said he didn't.
He also said somebody stole his hat. Of course, he could have been lying.
Why would that man lie about somebody stealing his hat?
If he wasn't lying, who would steal an old felt hat and leave that fancy silver hat band behind?
There was a brief rainstorm that night. It kept me up for a while. That and what Joe had said about the silver hat band. The next morning, I again accompanied Joe to his office. We both spent the greater part of 2 hours sorting through paperwork. Joe updating the entire file of unsolved misdemeanors, while I sifted through volumes of witchcraft reports.
Law and order, Leaphorn. When did he come in? What? Donato? How the devil did he get down there? You think so, huh? All right, I'll be there as soon as I can.
Horseman?
Better forget lunch. It's Horseman, all right. He's dead.
It was 45 minutes to Ganado. Joe was strangely silent throughout the drive. Every so often, he'd shake his head. What is it, Joe?
It doesn't figure, Berg. The preliminary report listed cause of death as alcohol poisoning.
Well, he could have got hold of a bad bottle.
Could be. We were looking for someone up in the hills making rot gut with his own still a few years back. We never found him. But what's really bugging me is where they found Horseman's body. I was sure he'd be up in the Lucachucas. Granado's nowhere near there.
Well, he might have got word and was coming in.
No, wrong direction. I was so sure.
Well, don't feel too bad, Joe. You're 35 years old and you just made your first mistake. The late morning sun was hot by the time we arrived at the edge of Granado's Tishaw Wash. The coroner, Rudolph Bitsy, a short, chubby, middle-aged man, was waiting for us in the shade.
Find anything interesting?
I haven't looked at him yet. Officer Roman Horse went back to town with the man who found the body, thing of Begay.
This the bottle?
It must be. Nothing been touched. Begay was pretty upset. Says an owl flew right in front of his truck just before he found the body.
Death omen? Ghosts?
Well, like I said, he was pretty upset.
Well, let's get to it. Whose blanket?
Begay's. Says he don't want it back.
Well, here goes.
Oh, my God.
Bitsy closed his eyes.
Looks like he had some sort of seizure.
Now, notice how the legs are stretched out straight.
You could have pushed him out that way after he fell down.
But if you do that while you're lying on the ground, it would push your pants cuffs away from your ankles.
Well, you think he was dead and somebody put him there?
Maybe. And whoever did it didn't know it was going to rain, so they brushed out their tracks with this branch.
Why move him here by the road? I mean, in plain sight. Unless
somebody wanted us to find him.
Canfield's camper was parked outside when we arrived back at Joe's office. He was waiting for us inside.
Trick or treat.
Hello, Jeremy. I'd like to have you meet Joe Leaphorn.
Joe, it's a pleasure. I've heard a lot about you.
Joe, this is Dr. Jeremy Canfield.
Doctor?
Well, Berg, when do we start?
I think Joe's got work to do, so why don't we leave now?
Fine with me.
Joe, look, I'll be in touch, huh? We'll be out in Many Ruins Canyon if you want to find me for any reason. I drove the truck and Jeremy followed with the camper. The afternoon sun shone brightly as we descended the dirt road into the upper canyon. As we dropped deeper into the ravine, the light grew progressively less intense. The cliffs closed in, rising in sheer, almost smooth walls, nearly 400 feet to a narrow slit of sky above. We found a likely camp, a small grotto, with enough soil to support an expanse of grass and even a growth of young cottonwoods and willows. We set up the tent and settled in.
There. That's about it.
Well, I should hope so. Was there anything at Shoemaker's that you didn't buy?
As a matter of fact, there was. This letter.
Oh, what letter?
From Ellen Leone. It was sent from Page, Arizona. She's checking the trading posts around Mormon Ridge, and if she doesn't find her man, she'll be here in a day or so. I left her a note at Shoemaker's with a map showing her how to get here.
Well, let's hope she doesn't need it.
Well, I hope she does. You know, not every woman in the world is like Sarah. Sorry, Berg. I shouldn't have said that.
You feel like going for a drive?
No. I'm really, really bushed. I've been driving all day.
Well, I'll be back in a few hours. I have to see someone about a witch. I found old woman Gray Rocks in her summer hogan in the Lucachuca foothills. She was a squat, wrinkled woman, but ageless. I guessed she was anywhere between 60 to 100 years old. She told me a man named Ben Yazzie's sheep had been knifed to death by a wolf.
Oh, too much knife play going on. I have a cousin who has a nephew who stabbed a Nike over in Gallup.
I heard something about that. I can't remember his name. Did that guy die?
Oh, they say he got well. The boy should come in and talk to Law and Order. Be better if he did.
Well, how's he going to know?
I heard one of the boys from the Nez outfit went back up into Lucachuca country and told him about it.
Do you know which boy?
Funny you ask me that. A man up on the ridge asked my sister's husband the same thing. The man was Bill Akani, like you.
Really? When? I mean, where was he driving a green van?
Well, it was like a truck they use for delivering bread, with a door in back and a trailer. That was 3-4 weeks ago. I don't know what color.
It was dark by the time I got back to camp, and I was tired and hungry, having not eaten since morning. Jeremy had a half-eaten can of stew waiting on the portable stove. After supper, we each crawled into our sleeping bags and, in silent darkness, watched the moonlight the top of the canyon walls.
What was that?
Oh, it was a coyote, or she put his lost dog, maybe. Could be one of my witches turned into a wolf for the evening.
I say it's a witch, because this frog rock of yours keeps me safe from witches.
I smiled at myself in the dark. What I'd given Jeremy wasn't really a Navajo charm at all. It was a much older Anasazi fertility token with nothing at all to do with witches. Of course, it didn't really matter. Wolves, witchcraft, superstition, and the look on the face of Lewis Horseman. Little did I suspect they were all connected, or what terror was all about.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, The Blessing Way. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour. Wolves play an integral part in Navajo witchcraft and superstition. In a way, a wolf is the devil. There have been reports of wolf sightings on the Navajo reservation. These are of particular significance to Dr. Bergen McKee, Ph.D. He's authored several books on the subject, and he has come to the reservation in northeastern Arizona to continue his research for a new textbook. He's brought with him a colleague, Dr. Jeremy Canfield, and he's enlisted the assistance of Joe Leaphorn, a full-blooded Navajo, an officer in the Law and Order Division, and an old friend of Dr. McKee's. Joe Leaphorn, a man who is good at his job, is not satisfied with the diagnosis that a local Navajo, Louis Horseman, died of alcohol poisoning. The evidence dictates otherwise. But Dr. Bergen McKee, a scientist in his own way, can accept the fact that the man is dead and leave it at that. Little does he suspect what terror lurks in the night to come. The Blessing Way will continue in a moment.
I left the campsite before dawn, called Joe Leaphorn from the gas station on the highway at Chinle, and explained what I'd learned from the old woman Gray Rocks. Then ate a leisurely breakfast at Bishbito's diner while waiting for Joe to arrive. I looked up from the grounds of my third cup of coffee and saw him come in.
Thanks for the call, Bergen. You saved me a lot of legwork.
Hey, sit down, Joe. You need coffee?
No, thanks, but I will sit down. Leave it to a white man to get through to an old Navajo woman.
I just have a way with women, Joe. Old women. They can't hurt me.
I got something else you might be interested in. A copy of the autopsy report.
Can I see it?
Here, take a look. Then let's go find that boy who went to Warren Horseman.
Subject Lewis Horseman. War name unknown. Age 22, address.
Read further down.
Estimated time of death between 6 p.m. and midnight.
Cause of death?
Suffocation. Substantial accumulation of fine granular material in the lung tissue, windpipe, throat, and nostrils. Fine granular material?
We call it sand.
Sand? In his lungs?
And not enough alcohol in his bloodstream to fill a shot glass. The medical examiner said it looked like he got caught in a cave-in, like he'd been buried in sand, buried alive.
You think so?
And somebody dug him out and laid him out there on the road with a bottle of whiskey he hadn't dropped? Not likely. There wasn't any sand in his cuffs or in his pockets or anywhere else.
Yeah, it wouldn't make sense anyway.
I think I know a lot about witches. You think you know a lot about witches. How do you kill a witch?
Oh, you mean, do you smother them?
Remember that case over in Fruitland? That guy whose daughter died of TB? He shot four of them.
Mm-hmm.
And then over in Teknos Pass a couple of years ago, one was beaten to death.
You think somebody thought Horseman was a witch?
Makes a certain amount of sense. But I don't know.
Hey, Joe, you're looking out the window like... Are you all right?
Why kill somebody like Horseman? Just another poor soul who didn't quite know how to be a Navajo and couldn't learn to act white. No good for anything. That Fruitland case was mine. I heard that Navajo wolf talk, and I let it slide, so we had five bodies to bury.
Four?
No, it was five. The guy shot an old hand trembler and his wife and a school teacher and her husband. Then he thought about it, and he blew his brains out.
Now, what are you trying to do? Figure out a way to blame yourself for Horseman?
I could have gone in and looked for him. Now, let's go find that Nez boy. Their family Hogans aren't far from Shoemaker's.
We took Joe's carryall and went to find someone named Nez. Someone who might have been the last person to see Lewis Horseman alive. I waited in the truck while Joe went in. Sometimes a uniform helps when you've got questions asked. Joe returned with an odd expression on his face. Well?
I found out a little. Kid's name is Billy.
Billy Nez. Did you talk to him?
Wasn't there. I spoke to his uncle. Says the kid took a horse this morning back up into the mountains.
Does that mean anything?
Probably not. The uncle says he does it all the time. Whenever there's work to be done. But he did say Billy knew where Horseman was hiding and went up to tell him like I figured.
And?
Didn't find him. At least that's what Billy told his uncle.
Think he was lying?
I'm sure it's the truth. The uncle told me something else. Billy Nez is Horseman's younger brother.
On the drive back to Chinle, Joe explained how that could be. The family broke up and Billy moved in with his uncle, so he used his uncle's name. The only name that really counts anyway is a war name, and that's a family secret. It's only used in ceremonials like a blessing way. Joe wanted to find a man named Sam George Takes, a law and order sergeant operating out of the Chinle sub-agency. Takes was out to lunch at Bishbito's Diner. He was a big, heavy man. To call him husky would be an understatement. He was digging into a hot lunch when we found him.
Yeah, well, you know how it is, Joe. Summer, school's out. He's probably off chasing some girl. No telling when he'll be back.
Well, that's right. That's what you do. Hang around some girl's hogan. Or if your brother is missing, maybe you'll look for your brother.
And he don't find him. He comes home and his uncle sends him in here like he said he would. We find out whatever he knows, which is probably nothing. And that's the end of it. Why are you worrying?
Because you know how news travels around here. It could be by now the boy knows his brother is dead. So maybe he connects it with this witching gossip. Then he collects some cousins and uncles and goes looking for the wolf.
Oh, maybe. Either you boys don't eat. This chip beef ain't bad.
Look, this is your territory, Sam George. Where would you start looking?
Oh, hell, Joe. He could be anywhere. You remember that bootlegger? We looked 4 years for him. We never found nothing.
What about that rocket the military lost 3 or 4 years ago? They ever find it?
I don't know. I don't think they ever did. There was a $10,000 reward.
Be right back. I've got a phone call to make.
Boy, you can't beat this place for a hot meal. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You gonna have something?
No, I already ate. Look, what's this about a lost rocket?
Oh, they shoot them off over at the Tonopah site, clear over to White Sands, New Mexico. Right over the reservation. Used to lose one now and then, but they got a radar station now over at Tall Poles Butte, track them all the way to the ground.
Yeah, that's science for you.
Yeah. Hey, you're a scientist, aren't you?
Not the same thing. I'm an anthropologist.
Oh, yeah. Old bones and stuff like that, right?
Yeah, that's close. By the way, you wouldn't happen to know where a man called Ben Yazzie has been keeping his summer hogan, would you?
Yazzie. Oh, sure. He used to graze some sheep way up on the high slopes over between Horse Fell and Many Ruins Canyons. Nice fellow. How about a cup of coffee? Come on, it won't kill you.
Well, there went our motive. Colonel Stump said the reward expired 2 years ago. They never found it, and they hope it stays lost. The bird's obsolete.
There was nothing I could do to console Joe Leaphorn. He was the most pig-headed man I ever met. Maybe that's why he's good at what he does. I decided to leave the business of murder to Joe and carry on about my own business, witchcraft and superstition. I stopped back at camp to see if Jeremy was around, but he was gone. From there, I went off to find Ben Yossi. It was really beautiful country, a bonanza to the artist's eye. Exciting frontier still untouched by what we city folks call civilization. The white man looks at it and calls it a desert. The Navajo name for it means beautiful valley. I drove past several small grassy meadows on my way to the upper slopes. Some were barren, having been heavily grazed by sheep, but most of them were green and full. Ben Yossi must have been terribly frightened of something and moved his flock to higher country. I honked a horn when I crossed the finally eroded ridge and saw Ben Yossi's hogan on the slope below. Merely a gesture of courtesy. Official notice that a visitor was coming. No cooking pots hung under the brush shelter. No clothing hung out in the air. No overt sign that anyone was living there at all. Ben Yossi? Anyone here? I sat on the running board of the truck and leaned back against the door. It was easy to see why Ben Yossi had built his hogan here. Steep sandstone cliffs rising abruptly on two sides afforded the hogan shelter from the southwest winds and shade from the late afternoon sun. I studied the cliffs. 200 feet of sheer, smooth, reddish stone with streaks of dark discoloration from seepage, and then a softer layer of gray, pocked and carved with blowholes and caves. To the north and east was an expanse of colossal erosion dominated by another towering flat-topped butte. There was no grass in sight and no sheep. I wondered where Ben Yossi kept his flock. Surely it must have been nearby. Then it came to me, borne on the sudden light breeze that fanned up the arroyo past the hogans. I recognized it instantly. The foul odor of death and decaying flesh. I hadn't noticed it before by the hogans. It had to be coming from somewhere else. I walked slowly down the slope. I listened. Coming from somewhere beyond the ridge, I heard something. I was certain. Faint, but something. I hiked up the ridge, stopping to listen every few paces. But all I could hear was my own shortness of breath and the internal thumping of my jittery heart pounding in my chest. Finally, I reached the top and I dropped suddenly in the ground as a cloud of giant black scavenger birds erupted from everywhere. Ravens. So that's what I heard. I lay there on my belly and looked down into the arroyo. And I saw why the ravens and why Ben Yossi was gone. There were two sheep pens built of cedar poles in a semicircle, with the arroyo bank furnishing one wall. One pen was empty. In the other were 5 large rams, hooves pointing to the sky, with horrible, gaping holes in their bloody throats. After the initial shock of my discovery abated, I settled on a simple explanation. The rams had been killed by coyotes or dogs or even perhaps a wolf, but a 4-legged one. I knew coyotes were active in the area this time of year. Old woman Gray Rocks wouldn't tell me who had seen the witch. It must have been Ben Yossi. And after all, a witch is more than a man can be expected to cope with. I'd go to Shoemaker's in the near future and inquire as to Ben Yazzie's current whereabouts. His story would undoubtedly support my scapegoat theory. Although I had quite a scare, I was suddenly optimistic. It was nearly dusk by the time I reached the hard-packed floor of Many Ruins Canyon. The clouds overhead were active, and the threat of rain hung in the air. The breeze was cool and carried on at the fragrance of wet pine. Life in the rugged outdoors was agreeing with me, and yet I felt exhausted from my afternoon's outing. I had no complaints, however. Quite the contrary, I was beginning to feel exhilarated by what had begun as a reluctant decision to come back to the reservation after six long, lonely years of self-pity and solitude. My self-satisfaction was short-lived, however. Just as I turned the truck up the slope to the campsite, it dawned on me. It couldn't have been a coyote that killed those five rams. The cedar poles around the pen had to be at least 6 feet high. I remembered the length of the shadows and the time of day. Ben Yazzie had to have built the corral with coyotes or wolves in mind and designed it to keep them out. No animal could jump a 6-foot fence. Damn. How could I be so careless, so stupid? I switched off the ignition and sat silently for a moment, utterly disgusted with myself. I'd have to go back to Ben Yazzie's Hogan's and find out exactly how the coyotes had gotten in. A storm was brewing as darkness settled into the canyon. I looked around and realized that Jeremy's camper was still gone. It didn't really surprise me, I suppose. Once Dr. Canfield finds himself some ruins to poke around in, nothing short of a hurricane would catch his attention. Jeremy, where the devil have you gone? The portable butane stove was unlit. I touched it. It was cold. And it was his turn to cook, too. Good old reliable Dr. Canfield. Though I didn't know why I was worried about him. I didn't figure he'd be puttering around old ruins by moonlight. And the campsite appeared undisturbed, like he'd left after I did in the morning and hadn't come back at all. He might have left me a note, and then I kept a flashlight in the glove compartment of the truck. I saw the tread marks from the camper tires, and back closer to camp, illuminated by the flashlight beam, I could see the mess kits, pots and pans, a canteen, first aid items. Left me a note if he had. I wondered who inside the tent. My light attracted the night flyer's bugs, darted frantically through the shaft of light, thumping off the glass and casting magnified shadows everywhere. It was spooky. Both bedrolls were rolled up. No preparations had been made for sleep. I was convinced that Jeremy had not been back since morning. I looked on the ground. I looked everywhere. And then I tilted the flashlight so the beam exposed the folding table we'd set up the night before. And that's when I saw it. A sheet of white typing paper weighed down by the turquoise stone that Canfield had jokingly called a frog. His charm against witches. I read the note carefully, beginning with the letterhead. From the desk of Dr. J.R. Canfield. Bergen. A Navajo dragged himself up here with a leg all swollen up with snake bite. I'm taking him to Tiknos Pass. Be back tomorrow, John. John. Why John? I read the note again and stared, squinting at the signature. Was this another of Canfield's little games? A joke? Was it something very different? Something urgent. Had he issued a warning of some kind by signing his name John instead of Jeremy? But I couldn't sleep. My mind was a day ahead of me. In the morning, I'd drive back to the upper slopes to inspect Ben Yossi's sheep pens and perhaps drop into Tiknos Pass and see if Jeremy was indeed on a mission of mercy, as the letter said. Then I remembered our visitor. Chances were, Ellen Leon would be showing up in the morning in search of a missing engineer. Just what I didn't need. A woman to make demands on my precious time. Finally, I began to drift off on the precarious margin of sleep. I slid out of bed, quietly climbed into my clothes, drew back the tent flap. In a crouched position, I could see the moon had risen halfway up the sky, and the west wall of the canyon was flooded with pale light. Came screeching out of the darkness out of nowhere. All eyes, winds, and the jagged talons. It strafed my tent and it blew off. But I had seen it. The wet owl. In Navajo folklore, the wet owl symbolizes the ghost. The ghost of someone who has met or was about to meet violent and sudden death.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour. Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, The Blessing Way. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour.
Today's episode brought to you in part by Quaker State Motor Oil and State Farm Insurance. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
Been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater, heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in tomorrow. And once again,
rest your eyes and listen here
to The Zero Hour.
This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.